it was on three times a week, and it was a small cast at that point, and every episode got 13, 14, 15 million viewers. So you were instantly kind of recognised, and especially if you had a storyline where you were on, you know, every episode for several weeks at a go. When I talk about managing behaviour and talk about behaviour management, the idea that lots of teachers have is that that's managing the behaviour of the people in the class, and it's not. It's about managing my own behaviour. It's about managing your behaviour as a teacher in order to get the response that you want to be able to make learning happen. Joe Biden, Tom and Trump were in the top three worldwide trending all day.
All right, lads, welcome back to Midweek MC, the part of the podcast where I sit down with the amazing co-host, AJX, who is back this week. Sorry, AJX, hello. Welcome back. I hope you're doing well.
Did you? Yes. I'm very happy to be back on the podcast that I love so dearly. So, yes, very excited for this week's episode as well.
You're back for a good week as well, aren't you? You've made it back just in time for an amazing guest whose guest announcement broke the guest announcement like record by well over 600 likes. A mental amount, and rightfully so, because they're amazing. Do you want to introduce them today?
Yes, today we have on the podcast the one, the only, Sarah Simon.
Hello, thanks for having me.
Welcome in. How are you doing today?
Doing really well, thank you. I'm doing a master's in psychology at the moment, and so today was studying lots of things that I'm finding very difficult to get my head around, but I will get there.
Determination.
Well, seeing where you've come from, where you got, that would be the best part.
Yeah, absolutely.
What did I do today? I think I made a good few coffees, served a bit of food, but that was it. That was it, really. that's my full-time job. I'm a barista. However, we do on the side. Yeah, I'm actually decent as well. I am actually pretty good at latte art. I can do like a heart, a rose. I can do that kind of stuff. Sometimes a boot. Wow. You know, it depends really on how I'm feeling. But yeah. I'd much rather be doing this full time, and that's why we're sitting down tonight, 7 p.m. You probably thought, crap, that's like a really inconvenient time. I can be sitting down with my coffee, my biscuits, but no, I'm sitting here with two other British people recording a podcast. So
it's a lovely way to spend an evening chatting. Thank you,
bro. Yeah. I mean, you do it once a week. I know you're going on break. You recently announced you're taking a break from it, but this is something that you do weekly yourself, anyways. Yesterday you sat down with Harry and James. Last week you sat down with Proton Pixie. The day you sat down with Pixie was the day that our podcast with Pixie released, which was kind of crazy.
Lovely. She's lovely. Yeah, I've been doing this stuff for years. Before I was a teacher, well, I was a writer and then a teacher and then both, and I wrote for the Times Educational Supplement for 11 years, and I also did their podcasts. So I had about 400 pieces, features and stuff published, and did about 120 of their podcasts. So I've been chatting for money for quite a long time.
I mean,
I do lots of speaking at you know, events. I host events and that sort of thing, and chair conferences and stuff. That's part of me, you know, part of my job. So yeah, I do quite a lot of talking.
You're very good at it as well, I must say. I lurked in a few of your streams. Always nice to have one in the background while editing, because, well, not when you do it on a Wednesday, because when you stream on a Wednesday, it clashes with our recording, because we recorded this time every Wednesday. So that's unideal. However, when, like, yesterday's one, I sat down, I was listening to it while doing a bit of editing, and it is really nice to hear it in the background. Obviously, the mods, like you said in your tweet, had quite a bit of work to do yesterday, but it turned out to be amazing, nonetheless.
Yeah, I didn't explore that, but I did assume that there would be... there might be a vocal minority who were not fans of me just in general being alive. So there we have it. Can't please everyone.
No, that's always the way. I was going to say, you've basically done our job for us. Usually our first question is to let you introduce yourself, but you've already basically done that. Is there anything else you'd introduce yourself as to our lovely podcast listeners?
Well, I almost changed my bio yesterday, because in my Twitter bio, because some people were a little bit grumpy with me, and my favourite insult of the day was, hold on, let me get it right, lazy cat wife, terrible mother.
Oh.
No.
Oh yeah, you pinned it. You have it as your pinned tweet.
Like it's, you know, like it's the 1940s. I was quite into that. It sounded quite glamorous. The reason why I talk to lots and lots of young people is because my son is Tom, TommyInnit. And before his stuff got really, really big, I was on Twitter for a really long time. I managed the biggest group of lecturers in the country of further education and, you know, colleges and community education. We met once a week. And we did, you know, we chatted, I ran a national conference, we had books published, all of that. And so I had this group of maybe about 7,000 or 8,000 of people who were teachers, who we all kind of knew each other. It was this really solid, lovely community. And then after Tom got, you know, very successful, his fans found me, and I could no longer have those conversations with my teacher colleagues, and I had, you know, because everybody else got involved. And I thought, well, I can be grumpy about this and go, well, you know, this is kind of overtaken part of my job, and I'm going to have to stand back from that part of my job because I can't communicate on that. Or I can go, you know, I've got 150,000 young people who are interesting and who, you know, the focus of a lot of my work is people between the ages of sort of 16 and 25. And rather than have the ump because I can't have the conversations that I was having, why don't I just transition into having a new set of conversations with this new demographic and enjoy that and make the most of that and have a lovely time doing that. So that's what I'm doing.
That was actually a Twitter question, funny enough, from Kai. Okay, sorry if I pronounced your name wrong here. They said, how did you start your career? Did you follow on from Tom, or did he follow on from you? Which, I mean, looking just based on when you made your account, you know, joined July 2011, I'd be very, very shocked if you had an account that old and yeah. you just suddenly popped out of nowhere because Tommy blew up a little bit. But it's nice to hear that you were around, kind of, you know, you've always been like a nice voice to the younger generation, right? Because my mum, she works in a school also. She works in a teacher assistant at school. However, she's not a qualified teacher per se, but she's like taught classes and stuff like that, but she stays as a TA. But she works with a lot of what's the word I'm looking for here, like, you know, like a lot of how you specialize in like disability neurodiversity,
yeah, people who are
she also people works with like specific behavior. yeah that's it. She works with children who need the extra support, and that's her field. She sometimes runs like one-on-one. She literally takes groups out of classes because of the school that she works in is very welcome into that. So it's really nice to be able to sit down and talk to you today, because you are very, like, in what you do is quite links quite well with my mum, which is just, it's very coincidental but also really cool at the same time.
Yeah, it's I really enjoy my work in that area, and I'm doing less of it now, but I've worked at lots of colleges, and I've done lots of different qualifications and degrees and stuff in that area, and especially with stuff to do with behaviour and challenging behaviour and disability and neurodiversity. And I've done quite a lot of work training teachers, teaching teachers how to kind of manage behaviour and be kind of more inclusive in their environment or the setting, however they work, and worked with various, you know, sort of national bodies on that sort of thing. But I started off as, just going back to the whose career started first, Tom or mine? I've got 30 years on Tom, so mine started first.
I knew the answer, but I wanted to just kind of link it in and give them credit, because, you know, I had a feeling it was pretty obvious who
Yeah, no, I knew what they meant, and I'm not being snippy about it. I totally get what they meant. I went to drama school in London when I was 18 and did 3 years training as actress, musical theatre, and then did about 10 years in musicals, West End, touring, telly, comedy, all that sort of thing. And then I moved into writing, and I wrote a sitcom with one of my friends, and it got made by the BBC, starring me and him. Oh, wow. And that was a six-part sitcom, and that was the first thing either of us had ever written. With it being picked up straight away and all, you know, the full series being made, we both got excellent agents, and then I did a lot more screenwriting after that. Went back to I was in Coronation Street for 18 months as an actor, and then I went back there as a story associate for a short time. So we had, as a family, I had already kind of experienced that element of being a bit publicly well known, so there was lots of, because at the time, back in the Victorian times when I was on Corrie, there was only four channels on the telly. There was no satellite telly, never mind streaming. You know, the internet hadn't been invented. And it was on three times a week, and it was a small cast at that point. And every episode got 13, 14, 15 million viewers. So you were instantly kind of recognised, and especially if you had a storyline where you were on, you know, every episode for several weeks at a go. And so we already had that experience of kind of what it's like being a bit famous. And of course, Tom's fame is very, very different to what mine was. But yeah, after doing about 10, 15 years in acting, I'm musical theatre, I moved into writing after writing that sitcom. And then I had Tom and didn't really want to be away from home all the time, like you are when you're working in that sort in television. And so I did a teaching qualification just as a means to kind of go out and do a couple of lectures a week and, you know, put my mascara on. And I loved it. I absolutely loved it. I worked in like the scariest colleges where there was all sorts of like gang stuff going on and, you know, police there all the time, always something kicking off. And I just loved it. And so I got really, really involved in that and did a load more qualifications and university courses and stuff. And very early on from that, I started writing for the Times Educational Supplement and lots of other publications. So I was able to kind of document my own learning and my own experience at kind of the sticky end of education, you know, the opposite of the lovely A-level groups. And, you know, I wrote a weekly column and, yeah, lots of features and stuff. So that was nice to be able to bring the writing and the teaching together. And from then on, it went into doing the podcasts and doing the, you know, representing them kind of public speaking and at various government things and think tanks and that sort of thing. And then it all changed again when Tom Simons' stuff went bonkers. Yeah.
There is a lot said there, and I do want to talk about it all. So we are going to go down like the little kind of train here, starting with like one thing and then getting to the end. So I just want to cover all those bases and kind of make them all into topics in themselves. Just because myself and AJS have a few questions to ask. We'll start with the acting, the studying in London. Yeah. So we actually knew about that because you went and did drama, you were with a voice actor from Baldur's Gate 3, weren't you? Who was it? Because you said it to Pixie, because Pixie told us about it. I can't remember the name for life.
Tim Downey.
That's the one.
I was in college, but I remember him with a lovely bloke and he's done ever so well.
Yes, yeah.
But I mean, definitely. So have you. I mean, you're here today, right? That's got to mean something.
No.
I don't see Tim Downey on the podcast.
No, neither have I. So he can shove it.
Kind of then moving into like Coronation Street. So that's the big one I want to talk about because you mentioned it, which was great, but you kind of brushed over it all so quickly. My nan and granddad, they love that show. They've watched it like ever since. I remember when I was younger, I used to stay at the house and we'd watch EastEnders, we'd watch Coronation Street. There's another one we used to watch. I can't remember the name of it for the life of me.
Emmerdale.
That's the one. Yep.
Yeah. Look at that.
how did you get into that specifically? Like, how did you get that opportunity?
It was my second job out of college. I'd done straight out of college. I did South Pacific in the West End, and that was a big musical. That was really cool. And during that, at the same time, I was having auditions for Evita, the film, and that was a massive thing. You know, Evita with Madonna. And at that point in the script, she had like two sisters who were with her as kind of narrators all the way through. And I went back for audition after audition after audition. They kept recalling me, and I was with, you know, with the directors and the producers and singing all these different things and, you know, having makeup tests and all of that shit. And they did me, they penciled me for the role, and then they showed Madonna my tape and she didn't like me.
Oh.
So I got cut.
Who cares?
I didn't
anyways.
Get that.
Who cares?
I know. And as it happened, those roles didn't continue in the version of the film that happened anyway. So the role were cut completely. But it was a really exciting time, you know, being called back and back and back for this film that you knew was going to be massive. And I was so disappointed when it didn't happen. And then the following week, I got a call, my agent called and said, you know, they want to see you for Corrie. And so I was was living in London, I was doing the musical, and they let me have the evening off to go up for the audition. And I went up on the Thursday afternoon and had the audition, and they kept me and showed me lots of other, you know, I had to meet lots of people, and it obviously went very, very well. And on the train on the way back, my agent called and said, they've offered you the job. It's an 18-month contract and they want you to move up to Manchester and start on Monday.
You must have been really bloody good then.
What? It was. I just fitted what they wanted, you know, and it was just gobsmacking. And so it was, you know, my agent had to get me out of the show I was doing, and they were brilliant. They let me go, but it was just so fast that, you know, from the Thursday to the Monday, my life changed, you know, because at that point as well, it was paid very, very well because it was a small cast. As I said before, there was only four channels on the telly. And so that was kind of life changing as well, that I could buy a house at the age of 21 and that sort of thing. So yeah, and I went and moved up to Manchester and did that for about 18 months. And then after I finished there, I did lots of theatre. I did lots of, I blooming love pantos, and I know everybody thinks it's a bit naff, but I bloody loved it. Every year I did a panto. Second year I did a panto, I was there. I was always the bloody fairy. Never anybody interesting, always. I was the fairy, and Tom's dad was the musical director, and that's how I met him.
Just about to ask, yeah. Actually, like, did you meet before or after? But there you go, there's the answer. You met before.
Yeah, he was a musical director at that point, and we both knew Letitia Dean, the actress who's in EastEnders, who plays Sharon in EastEnders, and we both knew her, and then she was in the panto, so she introduced us, and that was that. So we were 23 when we met, so we've been together for 4,000 years.
I mean, come on, you're not that old, you're fine, I think. I think you're fine. You're over-exaggerating so much here for no reason, all right? You're great. I believe you did as well, AJX, obviously not the same one, but I went to the TommyInnit show in Britain. Did you, AJX, yes. Or no?
Yes, I was at the first one in Nottingham.
Yes.
Oh, well, yeah. Oh, yes. Lovely.
And I was at the one in London. And I was going to say, and there's a reason I'm bringing this up here, because firstly, I've said this before on the podcast, but I do want to mention it again. I am in a TommyInnit video because of it. You can see the back of my head because I was at the London show, which is really cool. So, you know, big flex there. But however, when we went, he did a lot of acting, and it was very good. Loved the show. Would you say everything, like all these acting skills, would you say that you taught him everything that he knows?
No, I taught him hardly anything. Anything that he knows.
Really? but you were an actor. You did great. I mean, you didn't teach him anything.
No, I don't. You know, we've always been interested in comedy as a family, and we've always been interested. So what he's got from us, from me and his dad, is kind of a love of entertainment and a love of comedy and the love of kind of writing and the structure of comedy. And when he was a tiny little boy, he knew what funny was, and he knew what to. Yeah. He understood how to make people laugh when he was like three, and he'd wait for applause and so, do you know what I mean? He properly understood what funny was. And that's just him. But you know, I haven't taught him anything like that. You know, it's we're just a family who really enjoys comedy and really enjoys kind of storytelling, and always have. And it was always a, you know, probably from too young an age, he was our routine before he went to bed was we'd all watch a 20-minute sitcom before he went to bed. And you know, we'd watch Parks and Recreation or The American Office or Community, or you know, a whole range of different sitcoms that we'd really, really enjoy. And we talk about why they were funny and why they were, you know, why they worked and different characters. But what he does is, you know, entirely his entirely him, you know. He's just really good at stuff. I was at both of those shows, by the way, the Nottingham one and the London one.
Oh yes, I saw you there.
I should have went up and said hi.
I was at the top and I was upstairs, and I believe you were in the downstairs section, so
it was really good fun. The one at the Apollo on the lap, that was the last night, and it was really, really nice.
The London one was actually the first time I've ever like posted a picture. Oh, it wasn't even me actually. I went with one of my friends, Peter Pi 25. He flew over from America, and like just he was staying in Europe, so he came to England. I said to him, "Why you're in England? Let's just go to the TommyInnit show." And he's like, "Sure, why not?" So we went, and I actually said to him, "Take a picture of me like sitting here. We'll make it like a joke." We got in really, really early because like near the front of the queue. There's like a picture of me like holding a beer or like the beer on the floor, and there's nobody sitting near me. Like the seats are completely empty, and he's hold on, let me find the exact tweet, because it was in our heads, it was hilarious, and it was the first time that there's ever been a picture of me like myself posted online. Because I mean I face revealed since with the podcast, it's brought out like a lot of confidence in me. But let me find the tweet, because it is a really, really good one. Where is it?
Okay, that was brilliant. The last night, everybody had got the hang of it. and I understand that the American show is even better. It's just getting better and better and better. So yeah, but I haven't seen that yet. On Monday, me and Molly are going. Tom's girlfriend.
Ah, there's a link there. Who is my guy waiting for? And it's just me drinking a beer with nobody else in there.
I was gonna ask. I do remember the first show. I don't think like anyone knew that it was meant to. There's obviously, I won't spoil the show for anyone that hasn't watched it yet. There's a cliffhanger in the middle. In the Nottingham show, it wasn't quite clear to the. I don't think anyone knew yet, so we all just thought that was the end. And the staff of this show had to ferry us back into the deets, basically. But
I think you can't talk about it because you know it's he won't be doing that same show in the UK.
So the
audience finished the half by the interval. It was whether or not he was going to pack it all in, wasn't it?
And it's pretty much left on that cliffhanger. we all were just like, oh, is it over? But luckily it wasn't.
Hello, Editorial Bits here. I hope you're doing well. This next section of the podcast, at least for the next 18 minutes, may be an uncomfortable listen for certain viewers due to trigger warnings such as doxing and anything you can imagine to do regarding hate towards Sarah and Tommy. If this is something that you don't want to listen to and you're listening on YouTube, please check the scroll bar or the description below for timestamps to skip ahead. And if you're listening on Spotify, please skip ahead to about the 41 minute 20 second mark. Maybe a little bit sooner, but better safe than sorry. If you do choose to continue listening and it does become uncomfortable, please don't put yourself through it.
And all of that stuff in the show is true, all of it.
Yes.
And it still carries on.
Yeah, as you've experienced this week, unfortunately.
Yes. Do you want me to talk about that?
Yeah.
If you would like to, yeah, go for it.
Yeah, okay. So on Sunday, I was having a rubbish day. I've talked before about my dad having Alzheimer's and my mum-in-law having Alzheimer's and my mum having a stroke. So the three remaining old people are not in a good place, especially my dad. And I've been to see my dad, and it's really, really sad seeing somebody you love just kind of slowly disappear in front of you. And he's coming towards the end now, and it's pretty devastating. So I came home and I was pissed off and sad and all the rest of it. And I just wanted to distract myself. And I thought, oh, I'll go through all my DMs because I knew I had a load that I needed to reply to or delete or whatever. So I went through all my DMs on Twitter and replied and deleted and cleared everything up and did everything I was meant to do. And then I saw this button that said ones that have offensive content. Oh, bloody hell. So I clicked that. There was about another 200, you know, so a couple of death threats, kidnap threats. With our address on, nice. A few unsolicited self-portraits, all that kind of shit. So it was delete, 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 you know, and I have to take screenshots of the threats and cause that we have a police liaison who looks after all of that. And, you know, we have our private security as well, who also is aware of all of that. And it's just, you know, we've had so many that it's just, you know, it used to be traumatic and now it's like, oh, just fuck off.
Getting on my nerves. Yeah.
And you just take it with a pinch of salt. So after I'd got rid of them all, I noticed that the only one I had left that I hadn't opened and I hadn't accepted was a one from one of Tom's, and I'm not going to say the name, but we all know, one of Tom's friends who we had a bit of a falling out with.
Yeah.
And
you hadn't read it before this, as you hadn't read the DM.
No, I had read it, but I'd completely forgotten about it.
Oh, okay, got you.
I'd read it, and because at the time I sent it, I was like outraged that somebody would message me to complain about my son. Yeah. Somebody who I don't. I'm quite close with a lot of Tom's friends, but this person I don't know, and they haven't always behaved. Sometimes they've been really, really kind, and other times they haven't.
Yes.
And I'm not close with them, so it brought it all back how pissed off I was that I'd received this long message telling me how awful my son was to his mum, and I thought, and I was pissed off all over again. And I was just like,
20-year-old man, like, he's an adult,
yeah,
and you're going running to his mum. If someone ever did that to me, oh, that annoyed me more than
I'm so angry at the time. And we made a decision not going to say anything about it, and I just thought, this was so long ago and it didn't matter, and it's just like a bit of nothing, a bit of gossip, a bit of woo, you know, and it was me distracting myself.
Funny heart,
so I just put that out there, and I hadn't heard anything from this gentleman since then. And I just thought it was, you know, it was just a bit of this is what I'm doing, kind of distracting myself. Oh, that was mad, wasn't it? Fair play. He's messaged me this week and apologized for his behavior. And I've said, you know, we all mess up. I've messed up hundreds of thousands of times. We all messed up. To take accountability for it, to take responsibility is admirable. And I respect that, you know, and I appreciated his apology and hurrah, we can all move on. However, his army of fans were not delighted. And so I've had many, very cross, very abusive, unpleasant messages, a lot of threat. I don't think I've had any murders. No, they were quite keen on the this week. And and really nasty personal stuff, which is just fucking noise to me. These are strangers who don't know me. They don't know him. He doesn't know them, you know. And I just think if you're that level of obsessed, you maybe need to have a little look at your own mental health and have a look at the position that you're in terms of wellness. If you think it's okay to defend your idol by being properly personally abusive to somebody who says something pretty, and compared to all of the other things that have been going on recently in Minecraft YouTube, this was nothing. It was nothing. And he apologized. So it was we were all done. We moved on. But his quite obsessive fans did not. Even got to the point where I saw big long discussions on Reddit and on Twitter about my fertility, why I only had one child, why if I could still have children now,
it's
all of this.
It's a weird thing to bring up.
It's so weird. It's such a weird thing to go after. Lots of things about my age. I don't understand why me being 50 is an insult. I don't get it.
You're wrong.
If I made those sort of ageist comments to them the other way around and said things about them being their age, it would be terrible and I would never do it. So the fact that they would say those things to me, and a sensible person would have just turned off the Twitter and gone away. However, just thought, no, fuck off. You don't get to say this stuff to me and just walk away and be, you know, the response you want is for me to be upset, and I'm not upset. I'm irritated. You've wasted my time. But you don't get to say things like that to me without me going, can you explain this a bit more? Because I don't understand your strength of anger. Just explain why you're feeling like this, please. Because, you know, it's baffling to me. It's nothing to do with the person, the hero of theirs himself. You know, it's nothing to do with him. I don't have any sort of irritation or crossness or responsibility for him to shut it down. It's not his responsibility. It's the responsibility of the people who see something mildly derogative about the person that they're obsessed with and turn that into they're going to me and they're going to, you know, burn my house down, and they're going to discuss very, very personal things about me, which, you know, and I did put out a tweet saying, you know, because there's so much about my fertility, which was like, why would you go on about that? Do you know what I mean? Because it's not something I've really talked about much. And you're saying that if a woman has one child, she doesn't count. Are you saying that a woman is only as powerful as the number of children she has or doesn't have? Because that's some blooming misogynistic blooming Handmaid's Tale level shit, is that? And I was just pissed off because I was disappointed that these young, because I have so much hope and so much faith in the younger generations that they're going to sort out, you're going to sort out the shit that my generation and older has messed up. I have so much hope and so much faith in them. And to see that sort of response from younger people, and I know it's a tiny, tiny minority and almost everybody has been gorgeous, but this vocal minority really, you know, I just felt really disappointed in them. Yeah. So, and as I say, it's just noise.
Thing is, though, as well, is even like I'm not going to say anything on it because I don't agree, and I think it's horrible that like they brought up personal topics such as that. The one son you have had, look at how amazing he's done. Like, it's not even like you know, you've had one son. Look how well he's doing for himself. Look how well you and your family are doing for yourselves. And like, it doesn't matter. Like, you can not like an argument in a sense here, but like all these people kind of sending like death threats or sending horrible stuff towards you, like them in like what they're doing right now with their lives in comparison to what like your son has done with his, it's just a big difference. And not to say, oh well, they're doing so much better.
better. As well.
Sorry?
And with what Sarah's done with hers as well.
Yeah, exactly. And but that's what I'm saying, but with the whole like fertility thing as well, I was trying to get at there, sorry. Just in general, you guys have done amazing. You guys have worked so hard to get to where you are. And that's, it sometimes can also be seen as like a bit of jealousy because you didn't say a name. You could have been talking about anyone. It could have just been really coincidental timing. It happened in around about the same time that Tom made his video. It could have been absolutely anyone, but of course everyone jumped and they assumed, and you didn't have to turn around and go it wasn't him. You didn't have to turn around and go it was him. But everyone, until obviously now you've said we know all know who it is, but until you said that, everyone just instantly jumped on a bandwagon and it was this person. And if anything, that makes them, the people reaching out to you and the people sending nasty stuff to you, worse, because like they've just assumed it's about their idol. And it's like you're jumping to defend someone who it might not even be about. So why do you feel the need to defend them if you don't even know it's actually about them? You could just be defending them for no reason, but you've jumped on it. And it's very, very strange. It's very strange to me. I've never understood it.
It is strange. And the thing with that video as well that Tom made, you know, he's mates with Logan Paul and KSI, and he was vicious to Logan.
Yeah.
And Logan didn't give a shit. He like, just did not give a shit. Because, you know, why would he?
Crackety,
you know,
as well. He talks about Crackety, and I don't think Crackety cared.
Yeah, well, I just know about...
No, you just know about Logan.
I don't think he was brutal with Crackety, but he was with very brutal with Logan.
Yes.
I mean, the video started with him, like, on all fours, eating out of a dead body.
Oh, God.
You know, that's how the video... Yeah. Yeah, and it kind of got worse from there. And, you know, as I say, Logan didn't give a shit. So I think the thing with that video irked me was the humour. There was something he's obviously humorously taking a dig, that the response wasn't either just to completely ignore it, you were cross about it, or just go, oh, fuck off and move on. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. That it turned into this massive drama. And as I said in several tweets, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter. I've just spent the morning with my dad, who doesn't know me, who doesn't know who I am, who can do nothing for himself anymore, who's being kept alive, you know, and it's devastating. Mm-hmm. So to come back and hear all this drama about something that just doesn't fucking matter, it was just like, oh, you know, it just felt like, can you please just get some perspective, because there are more important things happening, and that are happening to everybody in lots of different ways, you know.
I'm quite surprised that I didn't receive a single DM on the podcast account or any reply onto the tweet, because you retweeted it, which, thank you. I mean, you know, I don't expect people to retweet it. It's just really cool that you did. And like I mentioned at the start of the podcast, it smashed. Seeing 840 likes on a tweet, I tweeted it on my Insane Orbis account. And I said, like, I know it's down to you, but just it's surreal to see those kind of numbers from a podcast tweet. It's so crazy to me. I've never seen anything like it. I didn't receive any like DMs. I didn't receive any replies. I didn't have to talk anything out. But, you know, but kind of linking back to the show earlier, we were both AJX and I went, so we would have seen Tom talk about the same thing. And you've kind of mentioned it a few times here. How does one kind of get past that? Because I know you have like the police stuff, you know, and you guys went through like a really, really tough time for such a long time, and it's scary to think about, right? And not scary in a sense of, oh, I'm scared it's going to happen to me, because if I spend the time worrying about it, then, you know, I'm not going to get anywhere. It's scary in a sense of the fact that it's just, that's possible to happen. But how do you?
Yeah.
And I think it was a Twitter question as well. I'm not going to scroll, so I can't credit you. But if you replied with this, you're not talking about you. How do you kind of look past it? How do you just, I know once again you've done it for a long time, so it becomes easier over time, but how did you get to the stage of just not really caring about it? Or how do you, because you carried on making tweets. I mean, you kept fueling the fire, so you clearly didn't care that much. So how did you,
what, with the stuff that's happened the past couple of days?
Well, just in general, like the last couple of days that happened a few years ago.
It's not relevant to me.
But how do you get past it? How do you get to the stage? Because obviously you had this a few years back, like I said, Tom mentioned in his show. So how did you get to the stage of not caring that it's just noise anymore? What kind of clicked in your brain?
Well, at the beginning, remember, Tom was only just turned 16, so he was still my boy, you know. He's a grown man now, and he's completely independent, and I feel really confident that he's safe in America, not least because he has blooming excellent security and 24-hour bodyguards. But at that point he was 16, and it was lockdown, and it was coming out of lockdown, and the world was bonkers, and he was going up like a million subscribers a month, sort of thing, and it was completely bonkers, and the influence that he had was insane, you know. Least little thing, and he was number one all over the world on all the socials, you know. It absolutely bonkers when he had his braces taken off, when I cut his hair once in the kitchen because we couldn't get to a hairdresser, and you know, he went on stream and his hair was a little bit shorter, and he trended number one in the world, you know, because he'd had a haircut. And it was when all of that started happening and him earning bonkers sort of revenue, and he was still just 16, we thought the main thing to do, mental health was obviously my concern, because, you know, well. These kind of child stars, and especially ones where it's happened very, very quickly, they hardly seem to come out of it very well. So our first thing was to find a really good psychologist that we all see, well, me and Tom see individually, who is, and a really good coach who've supported us through all of this, like, insane stuff. So having that person, those people to, you know, to properly keep check on mental health and keep talking about it all. And also, because I said I'd had that experience doing Coronation Street and then doing some other stuff, I understood about that, about being famous in a different context to Tom, but I understood about it. And I understood that, you know, it's nothing to do with you. It's to do with the person that these people are relating to that you're projecting. It's not you, you know, so it shouldn't make any difference to who you are as a person or kind of do crazy things to your ego. It's your job. And when people see you in the street and they want pictures and stuff like that, you're really polite with them, because it's also they're the reason why, and not that Tom wouldn't be, because he's always polite with fans and stuff, but they're the reason that you're successful, and you're grateful to your fans because you owe your fans a lot. You owe your fans everything that you've got. So, you know, you need to have this positive relationship with them in person and online. When the death threats started, the death threats were threats, kidnap threats, and he was living at home, and he was, and we got doxxed, so there was pictures everywhere of our house, and, you know, they'd even gone back to when we bought the house sort of 15 years previously and looked at all the stuff from, you know, the images of every single room from when, you know, from that literature when you buy a house, and they'd like kind of gone over Tom's everything from his primary school to his secondary school and been all over the websites, their websites, looking for stuff, and, you know, any pictures of him on those. And it, at first it was really, we just felt attacked, and there were lots of threats, but the police were brilliant. They drove past three times a day. They saw all of our neighbours, talked to all of our neighbours. We had like panic buttons. We're on special list that if I call 999, they'll be here in 4 minutes. I don't even have to speak because it's from our address. We got some security, got some help with private security as well. So we had huge fences built all around. We just got like a normal detached house. It's not a big house or anything, just a normal 3-bedroom detached house on a road with others that all look very similar, but we had to have like 6-foot fences and 8-foot fences and electric gates put on the front, put all the way around the house, and
mental
cameras everywhere. We still have cameras everywhere and panic buttons and shit, and, you know, we just got used to it. It was the worst things were when people came to the house, which they did quite a lot, just turned up outside the house. Somebody driven from Swansea once with the kids and just came like knocking at the gates wanting to see Tom. I was like, no, he's not in. He was in. I was like, no, he's not here. I'm sorry, he's not. He's, you know, and people turning up from all over the country because they'd seen our address, just waiting outside the house and taking photos and knocking at the door and wanting pictures and all stuff like that. And I just think, if he's out and about, if he's on, you know, if he's out in public, he's fair game. You know, anybody who comes and asks for a photo or asks for a whatever, that's absolutely fine. But not coming to the house, that felt really like we were being intruded on. But me, my husband and my son, we've always been really, really close. We've always been like three of us as a team. And you know, you get that kind of, at first, as I say, it was quite frightening. One of the good things we have is my big Walter is a massive dog who is very, very, got Walter and Betty. Betty's the little one, the whippet. If somebody came to kill us, she'd probably just invite them in and help. Big Walter is very, very territorial, and he doesn't like men at all coming in the house. I mean, if there's somebody coming in, you know, if we're having something, some work done at the house, we have to put him somewhere else because he's just, and he guards me the most. He circles me, and he's, you know, he's an 8.5-stone big dog, and so I feel confident with him here, as well as all the cameras and the panic buttons and all that business. But yeah, it was traumatic at first, and then it was just like a pest. It was just a nuisance, and it was like, oh, please, will you stop attention seeking? And we did that. We had that swatting thing as well, where people ring the police and say that there's an active, which doesn't really work in England.
Yeah,
do you know,
it's
this
a bit
swatting
pointless
thing?
In England, yeah.
Yeah, in America, you know, the door down, and all the police turn up with guns and stuff. Over here, they come and knock at the door and go, no, we've had a report that you're keeping your son prisoner in the cellar. We've had a report, and it's a bit, it's like, well, we don't even have a cellar for a kickoff, but come in, do you want a cup of tea? Do you know what I mean? It's that sort of thing.
Yeah.
That's what happens over here. But we've had a few of those where we've had phone calls saying that there's been a report of an ongoing usually a hostage type situation, and there's firearms involved. But now we're on all the lists. The police just ring and go, we've had this report, is this all right, or is it just that thing again, when we just go into that thing again? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So potential people who are going to swat us, don't bother.
Hopefully none of them are listening to this podcast. Preferably we have Sarah Simon fans listening. We don't really want anyone. You're not going to get anything out of this podcast, don't worry. We're going to transition away from this in a second. I kind of just wanted this to be a nice little section for, there's always something I've like wondered about, and hopefully you agree with this, AJ. It's like big respect for just how much you just don't give a shit.
Feel like it's not my problem. It's just not my problem, and it's theirs, it's definitely their problem.
Yeah,
and we feel confident with the security that we have, and Tom has brilliant security in Brighton and all the rest of it, and in America, and we do here. So you know, we've done everything we can, and it's just noise, just distraction, just it's showing off. You know what I mean? Showing off, trolls. We don't like it. Don't get you anything. So you know, piss off. Stop showing off.
Yes, I think that is the perfect response.
Just block and go next.
yes. I was gonna now bring it back to your teaching, because it's especially important to me, and I think from the pixie talk you did, I'm neurodivergent, and so did you sort of start off with just regular teaching and then sort of go into specialized teaching with kids who are disabled or neurodivergent from there, or was it originally the field that you were looking to go into from the start?
No, I was teaching I'm most interested in neurodivergence within mainstream education. I do teach groups, and I have taught groups which are, you know, have more profound disabilities and that sort of thing, and who aren't, don't live independently. But the thing that was most interested in was and especially autism within mainstream education. And it came about because, you know, I'd done like 2-year teaching degree thing, and at that point there was hardly anything about behaviour or nothing about neurodivergence in what we learned. And so I, as part of my second year, I had to, and I was teaching literacy to people who were, and it was almost always young men who were on vocational courses, and it was at that point I was teaching in a college that did mainly construction, so builders, decorators, carpenters, plasterers, all of that. And so they had to come and do English with me if they hadn't got A to C in their GCSEs. And so I had these groups of young men who were between like 16 and sort of 21. And at that point, Nottingham was quite gang. Nottingham was quite a fan of gangs at that point.
There is a nickname for Nottingham.
It's going up 20 years ago. Well, it's about 18 years ago. It's changed very much since then. But at this college, it was a big college. So there were young men from all different gangs, all chucked in this same, and sometimes rival, and sometimes things really kicked off. And so my first thing was, you know, until I understand how behavior works, until I can de-escalate and you know, kind of get their confidence and get their make them feel, can you hear my big, what, that's my big waltz going on.
Doing a great job of defending the house.
I thought until I understand behavior, I'm not going to get, they're not going to learn anything, unless, you know, if I'm always firefighting in terms of people trying to murder each other in my class. And then there were other things, like it was the thing that really kind of started me. There was one lad who bear in mind, I knew nothing about neurodiversity at all. And there was one like big, strong lad, and they'd done really well in this class, this particular session. And I let them go 15 minutes early, and he absolutely lost his shit and was, no, we're not doing that because we finish at 10:15. We don't finish at 10. We finish at 10:15. We go in, and he properly went absolutely full on aggressive, frightening. And I just didn't get it at all, because I had nothing to say that he was, you know, neurodivergent in any sort of way. Nobody had mentioned that to me. And if they had, I wouldn't have known what that meant. And so afterwards, I spoke to some of his tutors, and one of them said that they thought he had autism. Or at that point, it was described as Asperger's. We don't say that anymore, but it was, you know, kind of a autism in kind of a mainstream setting. And I thought, well, there's something going, there's this whole other world going on that I don't know anything about. And if I, you know, he can't be the only one. And if I don't understand how he, at least try to understand how he perceives the world, where me changing a routine is going to just set him off, you know, I'm on a hide into nothing. I'm not going to teach anybody anything. Because if when somebody really kicks off, that, you know, all the learning stops. And so I took myself off and did another university talk on autism, and it was understanding autism was my first one. And then I did another one on another university course on teaching adults with neurodiversity, and then I did another one on disability. And the more I learned, the more so much kind of made sense to me about the way that, so, and you know, there's, it's not rare having people in mainstream with all sorts of different neurodiversity and inclusion needs. You know, it's not rare at all. But once you know it's there, it's like, all right, okay, well, I'll just check. Do you have ADHD? Do you have da da da? No, and you go and check, because you can see so many different markers happening. And then it was my responsibility to kind of alter the way that I was teaching, the way that I was kind of managing my own behaviour, in order to include people who were neurodivergent. Otherwise, you know, unless I'm doing that, I'm not a proper teacher. You know, the idea of teaching only one type of person, because, you know, and I always say this, if there's 200 people with autism, there's 200 different types of autism. You know, nobody's going to present in the same way. And as that same goes for ADHD, or, you know, Tourette's, or whatever else, you know, is going on. But I just felt like there was this whole world I knew nothing about. And the more I learned, the more interested I became in it, and more kind of aware I was that it's everywhere. And there's lots and lots, there's a huge population of people who are neurodivergent, you know. And when I talk about managing behaviour, and talk about behaviour management, the idea that lots of teachers have is that that's managing the behaviour of the people in the class. And it's not. It's about managing my own behaviour. It's about managing your behaviour as a teacher in order to get the response that you want to be able to make learning happen, you know. So, because the only behaviour anybody can manage is their own, you know.
Yes.
So that's how I got interested in it, and ended up doing more and more and more stuff around inclusion, and, you know, get to the point where I'm training teachers, working with, you know, leadership teams at colleges, and working with various CEOs and leaders about neurodivergence, and about, you know, making the environment inclusive.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. I think I have DCD, which is one of the lesser talked about neurodivergence. At least I think. I might, you know, there might be actual studies that prove me wrong. You know, through school and such, I'm a bit older than Tommy and Orbitz here. I didn't even know that neurodivergence was a thing. I only knew I had DCD. I did not know there was a group sort of umbrella term for autism, DCD, dyslexia and such. And yeah, that made it very difficult too, because I was put in a lot of special classes to sort of deal with this and help my learning. But it was difficult because you're getting put in with a bunch of other people that have different stuff to you as well. What I'm leading to is because we had a question from Zyphia, hopefully I'm saying that right, to the person that asked this, and they put, how do you see neurodivergence interacting with each other, with others easily in an online space? Because it's much more difficult in an online space in ways, but also sometimes easier, especially now that it's a lot more open, at least I think, neurodivergent diversity.
Yeah. Well, first off, I hardly ever hear it called DCD, and I love that's what you call it, because you know, instead of dyspraxia, which is, you know, what people used to call it.
Yes. When I was first doing everything, it was called dyspraxia, and I think I must have been about 15 when someone actually went, yeah, that's called DCD, not dyspraxia.
Yeah, I mean, there's still that hangover where you know when you talk about one that I almost always have to mention, well, in my experiences, you know, working with teachers and stuff, almost always have to mention the other version of it. But that's, I really like that's, you know, that's kind of the more general now. As far as, what was it about people interacting in an online space who are neurodivergent? I think it's, you know, it's a, first off, it's if it's something that you want to, that people want to share that they are, I don't, you know, it's maybe having something in their bio saying that they're neurodivergent, if they want to, and if, you know, if they're worried that people might misinterpret their style of communication. But I think, you know, having neurodivergence, having been, and being kind, are two separate things, you know. So you can have any sort of neurodiversity or different way of communicating and be kind to other people and be respectful to other people and be polite and treat people online as you would in real life. You know, what I do think is brilliant about the online space is the ability to kind of connect with other people who are in a similar position to yourself, whether, you know, whether you're, you know, if you have a specific inclusion need or a specific way of communicating or a way of kind of seeing or understanding the world, there will be a group of other people who are also in that position. And I just really like that idea of finding your people, you know, like I was with my groups of teachers that I used to have. We were all each other's people. Do you know what I mean? Finding your tribe. And we were, you know, whether it's teaching or whether it's people who have, you know, a specific way of learning or way of understanding, or, you know, it can be that level on identity or profession or inclusion need, or it can be just that you're really into a specific band or a specific YouTuber or a specific, do you know what I mean? You have, yeah, you have something else that you can unite on and be part of a community. And I mean, even though I've had a bit of a rough time the past, you know, on and off past 4 years, but certainly the past few days, I love social media for that you can have a community of like-minded people. And there's a lot of support in that, and a lot of, you know, knowing that you're not on your own.
My mom, she's like, I won't say too much of what she does because I'm just a bit more kind of like private with, like, talking about my family. I can talk about so much, right? But like, she does her own little business stuff on the side, and she's doing really, really well. But when I was like younger, and I used to kind of play Xbox, when I was like, when Tom kind of like blowing up a little bit, when I was 16, I was playing Rainbow Six Siege on my Xbox, and I wasn't allowed on my Xbox past 7 p.m. because I had to go to sleep and do GCSEs and stuff. So it was quite different. But like, my parents, they understood social media and all this kind of stuff, but they didn't understand it fully, right? When I'd like tell people stuff, I was always very careful of it. It was always like, oh no, don't tell anyone your first name. Like, and I understand it's very dangerous. But nowadays, with like what my mom does, she's realized it's a lot easier to make friends online than it is on, like, for instance, like all of her work colleagues, maybe one or two understand what she does, but she has so many friends online who relate to the same thing. Me, and this is going to sound really lonely, but it's not. I don't have any in-person friends anymore. I have two. One of them I go to football games with, one of them we check in every 6 months, right? They're my only in-person friends. All of my friends are online because the group I went to school with, none of them, you know, do a podcast, none of them play games, none of them play Minecraft. Whereas AJX here loves talking, loves the podcast, loves Minecraft. The listeners, they love the podcast, they love Minecraft. It's a lot easier to relate to them online than it is to people in person, kind of, no?
Yeah, but I think also those relationships that you do build in an online space can move into real life if you want them to, you know, but starting them, and two of my best friends I met them both online. Yeah. Sarah Ledger, who's my middle-aged fat lass podcast companion.
Yes.
We are the middle-aged fat lasses. Yeah, I met her years and years ago, soon after I started on Twitter. We were in very serious teacher talks, you know, because she's quite a senior teacher. And whereas everybody was getting very, you know, it was very academic and very stressed, she'd turn up and say something awful or ridiculous. And I just thought, who's she? She's the greatest. You know, and then she had to run a very serious chat on feminism, which she started by saying, where my bitch is at. Oh, and I just thought, I love her. So yeah, that was, I met her, we talked for a couple of years online before we met in real life, and now we're, you know, super close. We speak every day, and, you know, we've been on loads of holidays together. And then my other friend I met through, her son liked Tom, and they watched Tom. Her son's the same age as Tom, and during lockdown they watched, and she got in touch just chatting, and we ended up chatting, and we're really, really close. And she lives in New Jersey, she's from New York, and she's been over, come and stayed at ours like three times now, and stayed at Tom's. And next week when I go to America, me and her are doing a road trip around all the different cities where Tom is, because I'm not going on a blooming tour bus. me and her are in her car staying at lovely hotels.
But while
poor old Molly's on the tour bus with the boys.
I mean, that's like AJX and I. Like, for instance, my mum, she went off to Scotland, and was it Scotland or somewhere? And she actually met up with one of her online friends. They went like for food in a cafe. They like, because they both like do the little business work that she does. This weekend, from recording the podcast on Saturday and Sunday, me and AJX are meeting up in person for the first time in Birmingham, because we're going to Insomnia, and we're going to go to watch a football game on a Saturday, and we're going to the convention on a Sunday. So, you know, it's really cool. like you can convert it into person into like IRL, which is completely true, but the thing I was trying to get at is it doesn't always start in person. Like, it's very, very rare you'll have in-person friends who share the same, you know, kind of interest as you, whereas like AJX and I mean I hope AJX I'm kind of speaking on your behalf here, I hope that we can start doing more in-person stuff together in the future. I mean, as soon as we meet in person one time, you know, it'll be a little less awkward kind of thing. So, but I'm really looking forward to it, and you're completely right with being able to do that.
Oh, and it's kind of easier when you start online, because you can kind of narrow stuff down. Do you know what I mean? Is this person into the same things I'm at, or something similar? Is it, do you have a similar sense of humor? Do you find the same things funny? Do you have similar values? All of that, that you can kind of get out of the way before you actually meet in real life and find out, you know, you're not meeting them in real life and then finding out the, you know, something terrible.
Like TwitchCon as well. TwitchCon is in June, and I talk about this on like every single podcast, because the majority of guests I bring on are going to TwitchCon EU, and it's like a lot of people I'm going to be meeting in person, and I am really, really excited for it, because although it won't be like, oh, we're going to meet up all the time and stuff, it's also just a nice little thing of, for instance, Pateo, who came to I keep referring back to him because it's just an easy link here. If I ever go to America, I want to go near where he's staying, and then that's it. I go to America and I have someone to hang out with, and I have someone to be there, and he lives on the other side of the world. And why? Because we've been friends for 4 years, because I got invited to the same video as him one time, we got talking, he asked for my help on a topic 4 years ago. Bang, we don't talk much, but we're really good friends nonetheless, you know.
Yeah,
so where's AJ? Yeah. And I'm messaging all the time, so yeah.
where's TwitchCon this year, the Europe one?
It's in Rotterdam.
Oh, we say it. Oh, right.
Yeah, so I wish it was in bloody London.
We went to the Amsterdam one a few years ago. That's the only one I've been to. It was bonkers.
Yes.
Absolutely bonkers, because there were blooming billboards of our Tom everywhere. And they took me and him in for a look around the thing, around the kind of stadium type thing before it opened. And it was just mind-blowing seeing these like 40-foot billboards of him all over the place. And it was absolutely insane, that one was. And that's the only one I've been to, because, you know, as I say, I think he was only just turned 17 at that point. So, you know, obviously I don't go to those things with him anymore, because he's a grown man.
I mean, you still can go on your own back, no?
Yeah, I might do, but, you know, we...
Have your own panel.
we'll see how many more people want to kill me before then.
Oh, God. Oh, no, don't say that. Come on.
Well, you know, it's
a good way
things.
To deal with banter or joke for it, all kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, at that one in Amsterdam, we were just surrounded by security all the time and taken everywhere on, like, golf carts and all that kind of shit. And it was very, very high security with Tom and with me with Tom, you know, and so it was quite bonkers when we walked. There was one bit especially when we walked through, but the only time we walked through, like, I thought, oh, it'll be fine, I'll be able to go have a wander around and go and see everything, because I know there's I met some lovely drag queens, and I met some like art people and all that sort of thing. I thought, right, I'm gonna have a really good wander. And then as soon as I was there, and it was insane, and there was lots of young ladies camping outside the hotel to be able to see him and stuff. And then when I went out of the hotel to get in a taxi, there was loads of people who'd come up to me and stuff, even when I wasn't with him. And it was just bonkers, and so it kind of cut off the idea of me being able to just go and have a wander around, which and it might be different now, because, you know, that was 2021 when it was absolutely full mental with, you know, people being so full on with Tom's fan base. And I think they've just kind of got used to him now, which is lovely, that it's not that insane trending every single day, and, you know, everything he does being a massive deal. And it's really lovely that it's kind of settled into being a bit normal now. So I suspect that it wouldn't be as full on as it was now, because, I mean, as I say, walking through, the only time that we walked through, we had like 8 security guards round us, and people were just piling on, and it was just a little bit frightening. And there was me and Tom walking, and it was just like they did this kind of security wall where there was 2 each side of us, you know, 2 at the front, side and back, and 1 leading. And which I thought, as we were leaving, I thought, because it's almost like choreography to do that. And as we were walking out into the hall, I just thought, oh, this is ridiculous, don't be so daft. And then we got out, and people were just like piling at them, and it was a bit woo. It was properly mind-blowing, that convention. Yeah, and an interesting experience to have, but yeah, it was really unusual.
One you won't be fighting for to happen again, kind of thing.
You what, sorry?
One that you won't be like fighting to happen again, like you won't be like, oh yes.
Yeah, it was an interesting thing to have, but it did feel like we were in a play. It didn't feel like it was real life. Oh, wow. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It just didn't feel like it was happening to my son, and I know it's happening to to my son. It's not happening to me, and I'm the sidekick, you know, as his mum. But it still felt like this is too weird to be happening to our family, you know. And there's lots of things like that where, you know, the shows, and you know, the one at the Apollo, the last night at the Apollo when it was sold out and it was bonkers, and it was, you know, and the Hammersmith Apollo, such an important venue, having, you know, the Rolling Stones and the Beatles and Bruce Springsteen and Tommy, you know, David Bowie, everybody like that. Yeah, well, I'm our lad being on there, and you know, just seeing how the audiences reacted and screaming and screaming and going, and it does feel like we're in a play, you know. And yeah, you know what I mean, and some of those things I don't think you're meant to be able to process because it's too weird, you know.
No, yeah, as humans we're not geared to that,
and it doesn't make it, you know, and it didn't make any difference to Tom. I mean, like on the last night after the Apollo, everybody went, there was this plan that they were all going to go out celebrating, everybody was out clubbing in central London, and it was going to be this big night out. Tom couldn't be bothered. Him and Mole went back to the hotel and watched videos. Yeah, and I'll tell you what else was brilliant on that night. I'm strange and funny. At the Apollo, there's like a stage door for lots of them. People could come to the stage door and wait for autographs and wait for pictures and that kind of stuff. And there was few cities where it completely messed the, you know, the road had to be closed around somewhere around Glasgow because, you know, there were so many hundreds, if not thousands, of people at the stage door, and it all got a bit. But at the Apollo, it's all behind like huge gates, and nobody can see. It's, you know, the kind of like walled gates, nobody can see through them, all of that. And we parked, me and my husband had parked inside that, so inside the gate. And yeah, so after the show, there was a little bit of a party in his dressing room, and then me and my husband set off home. We didn't realise there was hundreds of people still waiting on the other side of the gates. And I'd got a load of snacks from the crew room. I'd seen, oh, so I had a big drink, I had a big can of Dr. Pepper, I'd found some cheese strings, I thought I'll have a go on them. So I'm tucking into my cheese strings and swinging me Dr. Pepper, and we get through these gates, and all of a sudden there's people running at the car, putting cameras against them, taking photos, and I thought, I'm just here eating my cheese strings, what's going on? It's like the least glamorous photos ever, me tipping cheese strings down my face and holding Dr. Pepper and, you know, just looking confused. But
fair,
that's the only time that's happened. I know, yeah. Top marks on the snackage, but, you know, I was just a bit, we were really surprised by that because that hasn't happened before, people running at the car. I just wish I'd have been even slightly glamorous at that point.
I guess with you talking about the billboards, it's a perfect time to ask a question that we got a lot of from our Twitter questions, and that's when did you first realise you had, and I'll quote Tommy here, a child celebrity of a son, as he put it last video, in his last video.
Oh,
he said he
was
a child celebrity.
Leading to a joke, didn't he, which I won't say, but
yeah.
It went absolutely bonkers.
Yes.
When the whole world was shut down during lockdown, during 2020, it was really strange that we all went into lockdown with him about to do GCSEs, and the GCSEs were cancelled, and then da 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 da, and the whole world was like off kilter, everybody was shut away, everybody was having this weird experience. But when he came out of that, he was kind of famous all over the world, and what's brilliant about his fame is that it's very specific, and you know, there's demographics of people who know exactly who he is and know everything about him, and there's other demographics who have no idea. So, you know, and just think of fame being really, really relative, really subjective. So yeah, if he goes in one of the old men pubs near where we are, nobody will have any idea who he is, and he's not famous, because if they don't know who you are, you're not famous. If he goes in, you know, there's lots of different places. If we went in Garden Centre, nobody would have idea who he is. If we went in, you know, if he goes out in Nottingham, if in Central goes and he goes into town, loads of people want photos and come up and talk and, you know, all that sort of thing. So it's different to telly fame, where people have a kind of a general idea who you are, but they aren't that invested. This is a more specific group who are very invested. So it was, oh yeah, I do actually remember, and he talks about it in his video. It was 2020, I think, and it might have been early 2021, and I think Tubbo and Rambo, because they were all coming up and staying on our sofa, and Rambo and Tubbo and Bilzo, and of course Freddie lives two streets away from from Eddie Badlin, who lives two streets away from where we are here. His family are, and always, you know, so known him since he was a little boy. And so, yeah, some of it, I think it was just Tom and Tubbo, and they decided to do a live stream running around our little park doing like a hide and seek thing. And we were watching, and we'd said, I don't think that's a good, me and his dad went, I'm not sure if that's a good idea. You know, we have got these threats and that, and we are supposed to be being a bit careful. You going out and actually streaming where you are live isn't, it's like, oh, it'll be fine. And we just thought, oh, all right, then it's fine. And so we had it on the telly. Me and his dad had it on the telly while him and Tubbo were out there doing that. And it was just mental. We watched it, and it was like watching Blair Witch. You know, there were crowds of people just turning up. They'd recognize the park and were turning up at the park. Loads and loads and loads of people. And it was just like, shit, we need to go and find him and bring him home, you know. And it was at that point that I was like, all right, yeah, he is, people do know who he is. Because it was quite frightening for us to watch.
Yeah.
See, you know, just seeing all these people. It was like a zombie film, just seeing all these people kind of emerge into the park. And to go and find him, and he hadn't said what park he was in, but it was, you know, people who live around here knew. And it was kind of that when I thought, all right, okay. But that was the real life stuff. The online stuff was around Joe Biden's inauguration, when I'd cut Tom's hair, and Joe Biden, Tom and Trump were in the top three worldwide trending all day. Sometimes Tom was number one, Joe Biden was number two, then Trump, and then it changed, and it was like, but it was, that's, I just thought, this is absolutely frigging mental. And you know, we already had a psychologist and stuff, because it just felt like, this isn't right to have this kid who has so much influence. And also the stress of him, if he said anything slightly wrong, you know, as people do, as we all do, but especially if you're 16, that could upset people, you know. It was just too much influence, and I'm so glad that things are calmer now, you know. But that was online when it was, and I had friends ring me going, oh god, yeah, Tom's number one trending all over the world again. I'm like, oh bloody hell, what's he done now? And it was always something like, he won a match on it, or he made a joke about, and it was always something trivial. But it was really insane time.
I remember his beard. That was
his beard. That was over in Mexico.
Yes. Coming back, I think everyone was like, what?
Yeah, that was Mexico, me and Tom and Freddie. And we'd booked this gorgeous, gorgeous holiday. Me and my husband had a beautiful suite, and then next door, Tom and Fred had this lovely suite. And it was, you know, this real luxurious holiday, and we're so excited about it. And then my mother-in-law got poorly 2 days before, and my husband and was like, well, shall we just cancel it all? Or, you know, she has Alzheimer's as well, and so there's lots of things go on. And we're like, well, shall we cancel the whole thing? And my husband said, no, you go, you take the boys. So I was rattling around in this enormous suite on my own with two 18-year-old lads next door, 17 and an 18-year-old lad, you know. It was like, this is the weirdest holiday ever. But, you know, as I said, I've known Freddie since he was about six, so he's like a spare son. And we had the most brilliant time. And yeah, Tom had a beard. And what happened was, because we'd got loads of threats around that time, and so we were so careful going where we were going, because when you're going to be somewhere for a few days and there's that level of threat, to be really, be, you know, keep as anonymous as possible and just really work around stuff. And it was, and also the resort that we were in, nobody cared, nobody knew him, you know, so we could have dinner and nobody come up wanting photos, and we could do normal things. And, you know, we'd had a couple of years by that point of not being able to go and have lunch together because somebody had come up and want pictures. Of fair dues, if he's out in public, then, you know, he's fair game. But it was nice to have this lovely time where it was just, he was normal again, and it was we didn't have to bother about any of that stuff. And and then there was a lad who recognized him, and he was a really sweet lad, and we didn't say, please don't put photos online. And he was a lovely sweet lad, and he took a photo of him and Tom together on the beach, and then posted it and said what resort we were in. And I was absolutely devastated. I was in tears, and this lad didn't know he'd done anything wrong. He wasn't being in the least bit. But from then, you know, I had to talk to security, and we had to have a security guard and all that kind of thing, because people then knew where we were. And it sounds bonkers, but, you know, when you do get so many threats, you think, God, what? He didn't even do anything. Imagine if he did something political. He plays Minecraft and does silly things with his mates. And this, do you know what I mean? It's nothing controversial.
It's so, yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah. So the second half of that holiday was a little bit, you know, because we had to be aware of things again, because people knew where we were. But it was fine, and we had a lovely time, and yeah, it was a lovely holiday, and the boys were brilliant, and we had such adventures. And it was the first time I went swimming in the sea, and because Freddie's a trained lifeguard, we went swimming with turtles and stuff out in the Caribbean. Aww. and I had to shout at Tom and Freddie, because I'm not even going to say what they were saying, but they had this joke that the loudest they could say this awful phrase.
Oh no.
And we were just ideal time swimming with this, you know, snorkeling instructor person in the Caribbean, and it was gorgeous, and there was huge turtles swimming around us, and they were both going, saying this awful phrase one after another, who could say it the loudest. And and I heard Freddie say it, and I was like, Freddie, stop it, you're ruining everybody's holiday. And it was actually Tom, but he'd forced Freddie to say, he was, no, sorry, so I bollocked them both in the Caribbean, actually in the sea.
Oh god. It's good parenting, making sure they don't get in any more trouble. Another question, it's kind of a random one, based on like your holiday experience. When you went and talked to like security, so did you have to have like security guard follow you for the rest of the holiday, or was it just while you did they just stand outside your room? Or
we're just in the, they stayed outside the, because it was Mexico, and you know they have armed security around some of the hotels anyway. I just made them aware of what was happening, and they were really good, and just put someone quite near where our suites were, so just to make sure, just for our peace of mind more than anything, because you know, so if something crazy were to happen if something were to happen on their property, it wouldn't look good for them, you know.
No, yes,
that's just mental. Yeah. Though you had to turn around to security and go like, oh, by the way, like, you know, my son's famous, you know, someone's just leaked that we're here, can you make sure nothing happens? And it's like, that is just, it's such a bizarre scenario to it. Like, obviously it's completely like not in your sense here, it's just bizarre that has to be done.
Yeah, it's just kind of normal now, and it is strange. And it's strange with Tom in America having, you know, bodyguards, and that's taken a bit of getting used to, but they're brilliant and they're necessary. So
and
he has brilliant security over there. So, and you know, obviously the difference in America being that there's guns, so the security isn't as big an issue over here at all, because we don't have guns, you know. But it's quite final if somebody's got a gun. There's no messing.
Yeah, it's really needed.
And that was the same thing with being in Mexico as well. If you're in one of those countries, like being, you know, TwitchCon in Europe is fine, but like TwitchCon in LA last year, not LA, Las Vegas won it last year.
Yeah.
And I was thinking of going, but because I'd said a lot online about, I was really angry about the, you know, the different laws that had just changed in America with Roe Wade stuff and, you know, women's right to, you know, be in control of her own body. And I was really cross about it. And I'd said lots of stuff online. And also, you know, it was the same time where it just felt like, especially in America, there were lots of things happening where it was just regressing, and to do with LGBTQ stuff that was just regressing. And I was very vocal about it. And because of that, it was thought that I probably shouldn't be somewhere where everybody knew I was going to be for, you know, 3 days. And you know, I'm not Tom. I wouldn't have been given security. I'm not, you know, I'm just his mum, and I have my own stuff going on. But it was just thought that it wasn't really safe enough for me to go. But it's America, isn't it? They've got guns. That's the only difference. In Europe, it doesn't matter. You know, I don't worry about that stuff.
Kind of transitioning this back into talking about you a bit more. Sorry, I know we are doing some really like random transitions. Like, we did the first one from talking about security into teaching, and now we're doing America and guns into writing and podcasts. So, you know, very rough transitions, but how else am I going to do it, right? So we've kind of like mentioned it a few times. So you are essentially kind of doing your own podcast now. It's going to go on break because you're going to America, but you haven't done it. And also you did it for such a long time as well. It's going to sound like a really weird question, right? Especially because I own a podcast myself, but I'm asking it for the sake of asking anyways. What is it do you love so much about talking? That's all I got. It's like a weird question, but I don't really know how else to phrase it.
I mean this sort of thing is because I've done lots and lots of it with, you know, with my teaching stuff and with my, you know, you get used to talking as a teacher, and especially if you're teaching other teachers. And I enjoy words a lot, you know, writing is really my main thing, and I really enjoy words and how you can communicate, you know, a million different things depending on like a tiny different change from one word to the next. With podcasts and a lot of this I was doing for the Times educational supplement is interviewing people, and I love interviewing people. I'm just really nosy, and I've done lots of live interviews on, you know, at conferences on stage with various people, and, you know, education people and celebrities and stuff like that. And I really enjoy doing the research before, and I like doing a lot of research about them, what they're interested in, what they're into, what they're, you know, what I know as much as I can about them, and maybe write down 4 brief questions. But after that, I like just listening to what they're saying and picking up what they're saying and moving on from that. And I really enjoy that as a skill that I feel really comfortable with, that just properly listening to people when I'm interviewing, and being able to engage with what they're saying and how they're saying it and what they might be meaning. And also, I know that as a person, I'm quite non-threatening. You know, I'm a middle-aged, big lass, you know, I'm very motherly, very all of that, and so people do tend to tell me more than they mean to, which from a journalistic point of view is brilliant, you know, because I know that they don't feel threatened by me, they feel quite safe with me, and so, you know, they do tend to bear, which is brilliant, and you know, why wouldn't they? And I especially like that with live interviews, you know, just letting it turn into a conversation rather than a, you know, but listening in that. And I know I've done all the talking and none of the listening today, but listening is quite an underrated skill, I think, and listening without it being that you think you're constructing your own reply. So when you're listening, you're properly actively listening to that person, what they're saying, and not listening just to be able to reply. And it takes a lot of practice. It's a lot harder than it sounds. I really love that, and that's why I enjoy doing podcasts and doing streams and stuff, when I'm talking to somebody else and I can find out about their life and maybe kind of explore something. It can go away that we haven't, neither of us had thought of, you know, because they've said something that's maybe go, oh, that's interesting, I wonder what that means. And and also, you know, as I say, I've done loads and loads of qualifications and work on academic work on behaviour, and now I'm doing my psychology masters, and I'll be doing a PhD after that. So I'm interested in why people do things, I'm interested in behaviour, and I'm interested in why people do things and how they communicate it, and, you know, their attitudes, how they think.
I normally save this to after the podcast, and I don't do it with every guest, but I do it with some. I'm going to ask you live on the podcast here today, so why not? And I guess this is technically live talking, because I know it's not live in front of an audience and it will be edited up, but I'm only editing out like the silent parts, and like, so this is just a natural conversation. But because you have so much experience in that world, it'll mean a lot more kind of hearing it from you. How do you think we've done today in that? Because you've been on the other end of it, right? So you're normally the leading force, you're normally the one asking the questions. However, that's the other way around. We're the one listening, we're the ones asking the questions. So how have we done today?
I think you've done really, really well. I feel like it's been a lovely chat. And I know I go on a bit, but I do a 5-hour reply to a very small sentence.
That's fine.
I thought you've done really well.
That's perfect.
Not going, shut up!
No, we won't. We want our guests.
I was boring myself at some point.
Well, it's probably a lot easier to bore yourself because you've probably said this answer so many times, whereas this is with the whole security stuff, me and AJX only knew as much as we knew, but hearing it from your perspective, it was so like, I just kind of said it to myself, I was like, crap, wow, like, you know, I know they're really crappy reactions here, but you get what I mean, like, it's kind of just like, yeah, we haven't heard it before, and it's kind of links back to what you just said there when you said, oh, like, you sometimes someone will say something, you'll be like, damn, I want to know more about that. That has happened so many times this podcast because you're so good at talking. We have half the questions we've had, you've answered without us having to ask it, and that's perfect, and that's what we love, that's what we want guests to do, and that's why I do this. I mean, I've done it so many times where I've linked another podcast into a new podcast, and I that's why I interview people. I interview people twice a week, AJX does it once a week, and it's straining and it's tough to edit and it's tough to work, but it's so worth it for conversations like this one, and that's why I love it.
Oh, thank you. I think you've both done a brilliant job, really have, and it's just felt, from my point of view, it's felt really easy and really, really natural and really just lovely having a conversation with you both.
It has been. It's been natural. I mean, none of it's forced, none of it's fake. Like I said, I with you, and it's so funny to hear it, because it's nice to know that I'm doing it properly, and not from you complimenting us there. Also, when you said you go into it sometimes with 4 questions and a little bit of research and kind of just do the rest yourself, that's what I did. I said it to AJX before. I said I have 2 things: their Twitter bio, a little bit about their past, but like other than that, I didn't really have much else on you. And you know, we've been recording for pre-edit an hour and 31 minutes. And, you know, we still have Twitter questions to go through. We still have kind of that. And so it's kind of turning four things into 400 things kind of thing. So,
yeah.
Really cool. Really cool,
it's been lovely chatting. Thank you.
So I believe, unless you had something else that you wanted to talk about, that we're probably ready for the Twitter questions now.
All right. Okay, cool. Yeah.
I mean, do you have something else that you wanted to talk about?
No. I think I've said my bit about silly trolls, and I've said my bit about, you know, also, well, I don't know, I've been twatting on for hours, haven't I, about all sorts. I've said everything.
Actually, I do have one more question. Sorry, I know I've just said I was going to transition here, but I do have something that I just thought of. We didn't really talk about the whole psychology studies. You mentioned it a few times, but we didn't, like, I know you said you like learning about people and stuff like that, but how comes it's something you've only just picked up doing?
Well, during 2020, as well as Tom's stuff happening, my dad came to live with us, and his dementia and his Alzheimer's were getting worse and worse. And so I was looking after him sort of 24 hours a day, and I had to stop working. And then everything went bonkers with Tom, and my dad got quite a lot worse in 2021, and lots of things happened, and he was very, very poorly, and he had to go in a nursing home, and there was all sorts of awful things happened. And part of the thing with Tom's stuff was a lot of the tricky things happened during the night, and so I got into routine, and because I thought if somebody turns up at the door, if the police turn up, it's less stressful if I'm awake than if I'm woken up by the police. So I got into a routine of almost being nocturnal, and I'd stay up till like 4 a.m. And that sort of thing, because, you know, he was still a young kid then. He was, and I just thought, I felt very protective. Well, we all did, but I just felt like we have to take this in shifts, and somebody has to be awake during the night. At the same time, my dad is getting increasingly more bonkers, and, you know, doing dangerous things and all that kind of thing. With all this kind of massive stress happening, I started getting a bit poorly, and last year being absolutely exhausted, and, you know, I did like the least kind of, but it just, remember, we went to see Bruce Springsteen, and it was the best, because we're big Springsteen fans, the three of us, and we had fancy pants VIP tickets, so we were right at the front, and it was a brilliant day out. But I had to sleep for 3 days afterwards because I was so completely exhausted. And, you know, I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't do anything that would make that happen. And I went to the doctors, and I had loads and loads and loads of tests, and there's something very wrong with my blood. And I was eventually diagnosed with chronic fatigue syndrome, ME. And so I haven't been able to work in the way that I was doing before, you know, doing consultancy work, writing, doing, you know, 60 hour a week work. I haven't been able to. But because I need to, you know, I'm recovering from this illness, and still being very involved with parents, you know, the three parents who are old, and you know, two of them are coming towards the end. But I needed something for myself. I needed something that was just mine, that had nothing, wasn't related to anything else. And I did an English degree a couple of years ago with the Open University, and I bloody loved it. And I thought, oh well, I'll do an MA, and I'm interested in psychology, and I've done all this, you know, I have all this stuff to do with behaviour, and I love the Open University. It's such a brilliant structure, and most of it's online, and, you know, you have loads of, they're really, really thorough. And so I thought, I'll do that. So I started doing this master's for something for me. It wasn't about looking after anybody else, wasn't about my recovery, wasn't about anything like that. And it's brilliant, and it's really, really hard, really hard. It's 28 hours a week studying, but it's more than that for me, because I'm just getting to grips with some of the research stuff and the quantitative data, and, you know, managing data and stuff is so hard and so maths based. But it's given me such structure, and it's really brilliant to know that, you know, like with all this bullshit the last couple of days, regardless of that, I still need to get an essay in on Monday, next Tuesday. And, you know, and I'm going to do that, and I'm getting on with it. And, you know, and I can get lost in those sort of things, this whole new set of learning. And and also I'm quite keen on the idea of lifelong learning, that you're never full of learning. It's, you need to just carry on and grow and learn, and it's, you know, it's good for you.
We all have infinite potential to learn.
Yeah, absolutely. And it didn't stop just because you're whatever age you are. So that's why, so I don't know what I'm going to do with it, whether I'm going to, you know, carry on and be a practicing psychologist or what, or if I'm just going to carry on in academia and do a PhD, which I suspect I am, but I don't know yet. It's fun.
I had a conversation with someone earlier, because myself and AJX are working on something, and I'm like, mentioning someone. So like while at work, mid making coffees, I sneak onto my phone to like message people, and I was on someone and like, because he replied during the day. So I was like, oh, like, you know, I'm doing this. He's like, oh, is this all you're doing? I said, no, I got this, and I got Mayhem, and I got the podcast, and then I got like a video that I'm working on for the podcast. And obviously, it's like, how do you manage to like do all of this while you're at work? Because it's motivation, right? Like, I want to do this online thing full time, so I have to kind of put up with the stress of balancing about 5 or 6 different things at once. He's like, oh, you're crazy. I said, like, in a good way. He said, like, you're crazy, like, with it. And I said, yeah. And a lot of people have said it, like, that they don't know how I manage it, but I say, because you kind of just have to, right? Same with you. Like, you know, it's tough and it's stressful, but it's so worth it in the end once you finally get past it. Once you're finally in a place where, I have said this before, and it's a really weird saying, and I don't know if I made it up myself, but I'm going to take credit for it. Lose sleep now so I can sleep all the time in the future, right? And that's what I say. Because I sleep like five hours a day, and AJX has said it so many times, oh, you need more sleep. I'm like, I can have more sleep when the podcast is full time, right? But for now, I don't need to sleep.
Yeah. I mean, that is one of the things with our Tommy. He has a bonkers work ethic for stuff he loves doing, you know, for all this online stuff and all the, you know, all these everything. And he always has had an insane work ethic with all the, you know, his YouTube and his streaming and whatever he's doing. He's just absolutely 100% dedicated to it.
And look where he's at.
Yeah.
So, what was you going to say there, Ajax?
I was going to say, to be fair, I do have insomnia, so my sleep getting ripped from me is... sleep's quite important to me, young people, that's what I'm gonna say, despite only being a few years older than you orbits.
You're literally
young people.
You're 25 in a few days. Like, I don't want to hear.
Yeah, okay. I know, but
young people. Young people.
So you're less than half my age. The old one is less than half my age.
I can't imagine staying up 5 hours. Oh, but, unless it's like forced on me.
Jokes, when the podcast is paying for us to go to conventions halfway across the world, that's you can be faking me, true, okay? Yes. You can be faking me.
Definitely true.
I do, for content here, sir, I do all the work, like editing, promotion. And I've built like a little team to help out. Like, I have someone do podcast clips and like Jokana, and I have Aura do thumbnails, and I have like Tortillo manage the wiki. So I've built like a cool little team, but like editing, the promotion, the tweets, the thing. When I meet up with AJX, I've already said to him, like, there's a few times where I'm going to go on my phone for scheduled tweets that I'm setting up before I go on holiday. Like, that's dedication. And I'm very proud of myself to be able to say like that I am very dedicated for that matter. So, and
that's brilliant. You know, having that sort of solid work ethic is brilliant.
It's tiring. Very tiring. But yeah, nice. I'm looking forward to see where you kind of go with it. I mean, it's definitely helpful with your everyday life, and you've had a lot of experience with talking to people and managing people, and to actually be studying it. I guess, does it make it a bit easier kind of doing everything that you've done, because you've already worked with people, right? You've already understood kind of how people work. So does it make what you're studying easier or no?
The theory does. Understanding the theory, I'm new to scientific research, and there's a lot of it in this, so I love the theory. I love the research less, the science of the research. I like qualitative but don't like quantitative, but maybe that'll change the more that I get to know, more that I understand, and more that I learn, you know. And the other thing I am actually doing, which I'm just setting up today, is a Substack thing. So I'm going to start. Do you know Substack, where you write? It's like a magazine type thing where people can subscribe to your articles.
Yeah, it's like a blog, a little bit like a blog, no?
Yeah.
To put it bluntly, yeah.
Yeah, because with all the Twitch stuff, I don't take any. I don't even know what they call it, because it's something that I enjoy. I do, you know. I'm just talking to pals or talking to Tom's pals. We're having a lovely time, and I don't like accepting any subs or whatever it's called for that. But with the writing, that's the thing that I feel like, you know, that is my profession, really. So all these different things I want to write about, I've been investigating today and set myself up with a Substack thing. So I will be twatting on about that all over the place soon once I've got some stuff up. It'll be an extension of the kind of thing that that I talk about online. So, you know, stuff to do with am I doing this right? Am I being an adult right? Do you know what I mean? Because I'm still waiting to feel like a grown, you know. And it's this idea that people, as soon as you reach a certain age, that's it, you're a grown up, you can do everything. And, you know, there's old birds like me who are still like, when am I going to feel like a grown up? So exploring the stuff to do with with behaviour, to do with identity, to do with like LGBTQ stuff, to do with neurodiversity, to all of that sort of stuff that I'm already quite well qualified in, turning that into smaller kind of blogs and articles, sharing advice, sharing opinion. And, you know, as I've said before, I have made all the mistakes. So it's from a non-judgmental place, because I've already fucked up in a million different ways. But by doing that, I've learned so many things, which I feel I'm looking forward to kind of sharing in a don't do this kind of way.
Well, considering AJ keeps going on about how he's so much older than me, you could probably give that a read, AJ, and realise, are you actually that much older than me? Huh? You know?
No. Sorry. This is being turned around on me. No, you often call me old, so this has been turned around on me.
I've never called you old, AJ, in my life.
Right, how dare you? Thank you.
You're as young as you are. There we go.
Well, that seems perfect now to head on to some Twitter questions that we've received. We, as you know, this has been our most popular post, so we received a lot of Twitter questions, and obviously we can't go through them all, but and we've already done a few already, but yeah. We have one from Rivion. Again, sometimes we'll get the names wrong, we apologize to those out there who have asked them, and they've asked, how does it feel to have to deal with Tom's streams when he still lived with you? I get similar complaints from my family when I stream.
Oh God, I was, if it was me, sometimes he'd go on till 2 a.m. and he was so loud, and I'd just say shut, you know, and I'd be so cross with him if he'd forget and he'd laugh, do something really loud. During the day it was fine, or in the evening it was fine, and he'd do this thing where he'd go streaming on you not to walk in. But yeah, when it got past midnight, it was a massive pain in the arse, but it was all right. And you know, once it, after a few times of being really loud at 2 a.m. and getting massively told off, he didn't do it again. So yeah, it was fine. We're all quite loud in our house, and so we're kind of used to each other.
I find that so funny, because I do the exact, like, this before this podcast, like, I had dinner and I haven't even taken my plate down yet, so I'm helping with the washing and wiping, but I don't on podcast days. Obviously, dinner's quite late, and I open my door, I mute the call, and I shut down recording the podcast. I used to stream, like during COVID, I was streaming quite a lot as well. I was always shouting, I was streaming. But the only difference is I live in an old council house, so my walls are like very, very thin, to the point where, like, even now walking at this level, I'm not even shouting, I'm not even screaming, and my parents are sitting downstairs and probably hear the entire conversation, so they put up with it. But I've kind of like slowed down on streaming and stuff, just out of respect, because you know, I'd love to stream till late hours, and I've done 24-hour streams only when they've gone away on holidays. But I can get kind of carried away.
Our old house before we were in this one was a terraced house, and so we would have had to be a lot more careful. Tom would have had to be a lot more careful if we were still living there when he was streaming, because obviously it couldn't be crazy loud when there's people living either side of us. But luckily, yeah, now right. We're in this house is detached, so we don't have, you know, it's just us he was irritating rather than neighbours either side.
That's the thing though, is that even at like night time, like I'm streaming, and like sometimes my dad will message me saying like, be quiet, and like, not be quiet, like, not in a rude way, not in, like, he's never been rude, they've always been really, really supportive of the podcast, so like it's not in a horrible sense, to make it clear for the listeners here more so than yourself. But you know, sometimes people are like, you're just chatting too loud. I'm like, but I'm not even talking. You just messaged me and I'm not even talking. He's like, yeah, you are. It's like, oh my God. But I understand it. But like, you know, it's just funny to hear it's so similar where I'd shout down, I'm streaming, so no one come. And sometimes they'd come and knock on the door and I'd be like, I've told you I'm streaming. And like, oh, I forgot I have laundry. I'm like, oh my God, come on. But yeah, it's all harmless. And they, like I said, my parents are really, really supportive. And you know, I'm very grateful for that.
But also when Tom was doing his stuff, he was, and he's living here, you know, he was 17 when he left home, so he was 15, 16, 17 when he was here, and we were very keen that, you know, I don't really care if you have 200,000 people watching you live, but I've asked you 15 times to pick that dog poo up outside and you haven't done it.
Oh,
so do
God.
It, you know, are you involved in this family or not? You know, are you part of this family or are you not part of this family? Because if you're not, then we'll have to have a rethink, you know.
That's so good. Yeah, because like I said, they're very nice with the whole like Monday and Wednesdays thing, because that is a set theme. But I do it out of just doing train anyways, but like I walk the dog if I'm working early shift. If I'm working early, I'll finish at 3 o'clock, so I'll come home and I'll walk the dog. And I used to do dog at night times, but the only issue is every time I took him out, he'd wee and he'd poo and stuff, and then he'd still get my dad to take him out anyways. So we realized it's a waste of time me keep doing it, because
yeah,
he'd get my dad to do it. So but I'm always helping with the washing and wiping. Like tomorrow I will, and then Friday I'll be away and so are my parents, so it's like
yeah, we were very keen on that. You know, are you part of this family? You know, are you gonna, because you live in here, you need to do your bit, which is unpacking the dishwasher or doing, you know, vacuuming or picking up, you know, gathering laundry or whatever the chores were. That, you know, we didn't really care how popular he was outside of the house. You're in the, you know, you're part of the family, so crack on, you know.
Fair play.
Also, we didn't want him to become one of them massive wankers who just like turns into this egocentric thing and collects Lamborghinis and, you know, puts half a pound of coke up the nose every night, you know. And we just thought we just want him to stay as he is, and he has stayed exactly as he is.
Humble. For some bizarre reason, I've had
twat.
What?
Yeah, right. he stayed as a massive twat. Yeah, I wouldn't say big buff twat that he's always been. Yeah.
I don't know why we've had a reply from. I've just seen this from Crypto Signals. I'm not shouting them out, it's not a question, but for some of the reason they've just reworded the tweet underneath. Okay, don't know why they've done that. This one is from, there's so many questions about Tommy. Why no questions about you? Where's the questions about you?
There are a few there.
Yeah, but we've already asked these ones, that's the issue. Do you see one that we haven't asked? Go on in, AJ, because I'm still scrolling. I mean, a lot of people are shocked that we got you.
I have to find it now.
here we go.
I don't know why, it's just, you know, it's just having a nice chat, isn't it?
I think a lot more people are just kind of shocked at the idea, because a lot of like people listen to the podcast are in quotation marks TommyInnit's fans. So when you turn around and go, oh yeah, we've got their mum on the podcast, everyone thinks, oh, you know, it's TommyInnit's mum. But whereas we saw it very in a different light, like in the tweet I didn't even mention Tommy, I saw it in a much different light of you are your own person. But everyone in the replies kind of turned around and went, oh my god, TommyInnit's mum. I got a few DMs like, oh, it's so good, okay, you got Tommy's mum on,
you know.
Yeah, but
I'm
still, you are your own
about
person.
who I am as a person. And so at the moment, because my life is so much about my parent, well, my dad mainly, or our Tom, I'm used to being Tom's mum or Terry's daughter, you know. I'm secure enough in myself to know that I'm, you know, I am my own person as well as those things. But if that's how people identify me, that's also cool.
I do want to say from both AJS and I here, though, we are like wishing the best. And I know I haven't said this yet. I was kind of waiting near the end of the podcast to say it, but I'm sorry that you're going through that. I've got like my own things that I don't really talk about, and I probably won't talk about until the future with my own family. And I believe AJX does as well. So we, you know, it's we understand it, and not to, I don't understand it to that extent, but I have my own things. So I know you're not looking for sympathy, and I know you're very strong and you're dealing with it great, but I do want to say, like, fair play, you know, that you're managing it all. Thank and big you. Respect yeah. Especially even just thank taking you. Time today to come and talk to us when, like, you know, you're finding time to do stuff still, like tweets and all that kind of stuff. So just big respect, and I'm sorry that you're kind of having to deal with that right now.
Thank you
Oh my god, what, you know what, here we go then. This one's from Sarah. Besides being such an amazing model for your kid, what's something you find yourself still struggle but you keep finding ways to be better at? There we go, that's a good one.
Loads of stuff. I'm getting better with I'm a recovering alcoholic, so I've been sober for 8 years, and I've had lots of different addictions, and I'm getting much better with being able to regulate myself on stuff. So I'm dead proud of myself that I've, you know, we've had so much on, and that I've stayed sober throughout, and I haven't lapsed, and I haven't done anything, you know, anything other. But food, I'm getting better with food as well. But I am taking a food is like something that I love food, and I eat emotionally, and I eat compulsively, and I eat because I love food, and I eat because I'm happy or sad, or, you know, have a feeling.
Even I'm bored. And so, a lot when I'm bored, I'm like, eat bad.
And you know, sometimes I eat really badly, and sometimes I eat beautifully, but I eat too much of it. I'm super greedy. But I've been on a medication recently. It's the Ozempic, you know, that everybody's on in Hollywood, and that's really, really helping me sort of regulate my food. And it's something people have lots of opinions about, but with my medical issues, you know, the doctor was kind of said said it might help if I lost some weight. So I thought, oh, well, I'll give it a crack. And it's really working, and I've lost a total of 2.5 stones, and I'm eating really well, really beautifully. You know, eat everything that I eat is nutritious and, you know, proper food. I'm trying not to eat anything that's ultra processed or processed, really. So I'm feeling like that was like my big addiction, that because with alcohol or smoking or whatever else it was, you can just cut it out, but you can't with food. You know, and that's I'm rubbish at moderating. So that's something, you know, something that I am getting better at, but is you know, it's going to be a lifelong thing for me, because I love food as well.
I made a tweet about this the other day, but so when I was younger, and this is a weird Orbitz fact that I've never said, and this is part of the whole kind of being a bit more confident with myself. So when I was younger, I lacked vitamin D, and I was always going out, and I was a very, very active kid, but just my body doesn't store vitamin D properly, and it goes through phases where it does and it does and it does. Anyways, when I was younger, I was really, really bad for a time, and this is what I know from my parents. Apparently I was pulling out my hair and eating it, and that's because my hair provided like vitamin D. I know it sounds really, really weird, but I was also a kid, so I guess it's different. And
yeah,
they took me to the
interesting though that you were fulfilling what you needed in kind of a natural way.
Yeah,
you know, that your body knew that that's what you needed, my even instinct, though it wasn't, you know. Yeah,
I was also just a bit of a strange kid. I mean, I used to sit on the Hoover when my mom was hoovering, and I had a rack on our fireplace. I kept pulling it for months, and as soon as I pulled the rack off the fireplace, never went near it again. So I was just a bit of a crazy kid. But then recently, like last year when I was working a night shift job, I was eating like really unhealthy, because my mom cooks the dinner at like 6 p.m. So I was working, and then I was getting food at like 2 p.m. burger, chips every day because it was completely free, and then I was coming home and having dinner at like 10 p.m. at night, stone cold, obviously, and sometimes I was ordering and all that kind of jazz. And I got really, really unwell, and I realized, you know what, this is probably isn't the healthiest thing. So I left the job. Took me ages to finally settle back down, and I've been at my job for 6 months now. Don't really like it, but it pays the bills, so I just firm it. And so I've been going, waiting for ages, taking blood tests, doctors, you know, they was like, oh, you have high cholesterol, wait, never mind, you don't, that was a misread, blah 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 blah. And then realized that once again my body isn't storing vitamin D. So I've been putting back on medication and stuff. It's also just like, it's really annoying, because especially these last few days, or even these last few months, I should say, I'm always really, really hungry, and I shouldn't be this hungry, because I'm eating and I'm snacking, and I don't want to be in as much, and it's building the weight, so I'm trying to stop. But then when I get really, really hungry, I'm like, crap, I need to eat something, and then I'm really thirsty and constantly aches and pains. But I'm also able to lift stuff, and I'm able to keep active, but I still ache, and it's really, really frustrating. And I'm on medication now, so hopefully it's going to help, but I can't take tablets, so I have to have liquid medication. It's just, it's such a horrible scenario, but I can kind of relate in that sense of,
yeah,
the lack of vitamin D makes me hungry all the time, and it's really, really frustrating. So I tried to manage it, but you know, it's tough in that sense.
Oh, you sound like you're doing well with it though.
I'm managing. I mean, I after this podcast I'll go and take the medicine, because it does something. It's like 50-50, will I get a stomach ache, will I not. It's a really fun game after taking the medicine.
Yeah.
But a lot of times my mom will remind me, like I'll message her that I'm done, like the podcast, to let her know that I'm finished, and she'll be like, medicine, but like, okay, thank you for reminding me. Otherwise I really forget. Aww. So yeah, it's nice. Random Orbitz fact out of nowhere, sorry. It's just my way of relating to you is talking about myself. There you go. So.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I have a lovely question, which I thought was very lovely, from Croppo, who asked, how's it been watching your son grow into something he's passionate about?
Well, he's always been passionate about making films and about comedy and about that sort of thing. I mean, I was telling Harry yesterday that I found a picture of when he was about six at school. They all had to hold up like a whiteboard with written on what they wanted to be when they were growing up. And he wrote film director, and he was about six, you know. And he's been making little vids his first video he made was, I think he was about three, and him and his dad made our old dog. She's passed away now. She passed away about 5 years ago. Nora was, she was about a year old when I had Tom. And so him and her and Tom grew up together, and, you know, I absolutely adored her. She was nearly 17 when she passed away, so she had a long, lovely life. But he was obsessed with her, and also Indiana Jones. And so him and his dad made Indiana Dog when he was about which was a version of Indiana Jones, but it just involved really Nora with a cowboy hat on. And then he used to make loads of videos with like stop motion stuff with Lego, and from being a little boy. So he's always been really into film and really into making things. And it's lovely seeing him be successful in something that he really loves. And he's moving more into comedy as well now, and he's working so hard on it. He's doing lots of gigs, lots of little tiny gigs in London and in Brighton, and it's never advertised that he's doing them. To be able to learn his craft, you know, and really work his 5 minutes and work into his 10 minutes, and, you know, and he's reading everything and watching everything. And so that's his new focus, as well as doing what he's already doing. But it's brilliant seeing him, you know, really, really be besotted with the craft of comedy and being able to start from scratch on it. And I know that because he has that privilege, because he's, you know, he's done very well in his career and financially, that he can spend time learning this new thing. But it's wonderful to see him grow and develop with his stand-up. And he's very, very good, you know.
Nice to hear.
Yeah. Well, he was, yeah.
Yeah, I'm super proud of him. But mainly because he's such a lovely lad, you know.
Yes.
And we always said you can stop this anytime you want. You know, even if when he was younger and things were difficult, and he'd say, I don't have to do this forever. I was like, no, of course you don't. You can stop it anytime you want. You can stop next week if you want. Entirely up to you. But going back to education, the thing is that, you know, because he's done so well, that we've said, you know, if you decide get to 25 or 27 and decide that you want to be a plumber, you can train to be a plumber or a doctor or a lawyer or a electrician or a painter or whatever, you know, because you've got that. With the privilege that this first career has given you in terms of finance, that you've got that choice that you can do whatever makes you happy.
Never too late. To end it off the podcast, at least the Twitter question section, in the nicest way possible, this one is from Goofy Goober. What is your favourite song?
Hungry Heart by Bruce Springsteen.
Oh, there we go. That was an easy one. Didn't even have to think about it.
No, I didn't have to think about it. It's... when I was pregnant with Tom, my husband strangely got massively into Bruce Springsteen. And I think because Bruce is so kind of straightforward and earnest, there's nothing ironic, there's nothing jokey, he's straightforward and he knows what he's on about. And so listening to a lot of Bruce Springsteen, and he used to sing that to my tummy when Tom was in my belly. I used to sing Hungry Heart at him. And then when we drove home from the hospital after I'd had him, we put that on. And so when he drove, when we were driving home, and it's, so that's why it's kind of one of my favourites. Well, it is my favourite. And of course, he's grown up to be a massive Bruce Springsteen fan himself. So yeah, we've seen Bruce loads of times, and him and his dad went to see him on Broadway, and last summer. Oh. Yeah, so that's me. That's my favourite song.
What's yours, AJX?
Oh my god!
I have a favourite song of like, it's, I don't have to explain it. It's not my favourite song, but I like it a lot, kind of thing. So I don't really have a favourite song. Mine is Head and Heart. That's a good song. Goodbye.
I don't tend to listen to music.
Joel Corey. So that's my one.
Yeah.
Like 7 Years by Lucas Graham. There you go.
Yeah. I couldn't do this with books. Somebody asked me earlier what my favourite book was, and I had to send him a list of about 8. But with songs, because you link them to stages in your life or events in your life, I think it's a little bit easier.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I'm not going to ask you about books, then, otherwise that's a whole different
thing. Oh, no, I'll be here for the next 7 hours.
With that being said, then, Sarah, I believe that brings the end of this week's Midweek MC, sadly. It's been nice.
Lovely, thank you. It's been lovely chatting, and I do appreciate it. I think you've done super well. Really, really good. You've made me very relaxed, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Before I do the outro here and we do say our goodbyes, we always like to give the end of the podcast here for you to promote yourself. Obviously, most people listening to this will know who you are. There's also the case of, you know, I have a lot of listeners who listen to the podcast anyways, and they might have loved this conversation. I've searched your name into Google and gotten random search results. So where can people find you? Your Twitch handle, your Twitter handle, your YouTube? We'll have the Twitch and Twitter below, and the YouTube should be an end card. But for the sake of it anyways, for the sake of saying it out loud, what where can we find you?
On Twitter, I'm at Mrs. Sarah Simons, and it's Sarah Simons Internet Mum, as it is on TikTok and on Twitch, Sarah Simons Internet Mum.
Nice and easy. There we go. fit. To be fair, the title will probably just have Sarah Simons. So
yeah. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, AJX, as per usual, for joining us today. I've loved this talk. It's been amazing, and thank you for being here with me.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me on.
And thank you again, Sarah. It's been great.
Thank you. It's been lovely. I've really enjoyed it.
This has been Midweek MC. Thank you all for listening. Stay safe. Don't eat too much bread. Pieces.